I'm so pleased to be welcoming Margot Machol Bisnow to Politics and Prose to discuss her new book, Raising an Entrepreneur, 10 Rules for Nurturing Risk Takers, Problem Solvers, and Changemakers. Using brief vignettes of 60 parents of wildly successful people, many of whom you may not recognize their name, but you certainly will recognize their work, Margot offers observations and stories on how to raise high-achieving and creative individuals. From the mother of Benjamin Levin, also known as Benny Blanco, Grammy Award-winning songwriter and producer of such songs as Diamonds by Rihanna and I Kissed a Girl by Katy Perry, to Robert Stevens, also known as the founder of Geek Squad and the former owner of Best Buy. Many of the people who share these super success stories share commonalities as well in the way that they were raised. So in the book, Margot has taken these stories and distilled them into a list of 10 keys for raising self-confident and creative individuals. So Margot is the former FTC commissioner and chief staff of the President's Council of Economic Advisors. But her main qualifications for writing this book are her two sons. One founded the Summit Series, a conference for young entrepreneurs, and the other started a band, Magic Giant. Together, the brothers formed a nonprofit called Get Well Soon Tour. Margot will be in conversation with Jayne Plank, who is the mother of Kevin Plank, the founder and CEO of Under Armour, which is a sports performance apparel company. Not that I needed to tell you that. Jayne and Kevin's story is featured in the book in the first chapter, which discusses the importance of supporting passion no matter what it is. Both women are local to the DMV region, and we're so happy to have them in the store tonight. So please help me in welcoming Margot Bisnow and Jayne Plank to Politics and Prose.
Can you hear me? So I'm so excited to be here and kind of relieved that she's told you everything, and I feel like I don't have to do as much now. This is my first book, and this is my first public speaking ever, so all my friends know I'm just a bit nervous, but I'm going to get through this with all of your help. I'm super excited about tonight because this is my neighborhood bookstore that I've been coming to for years, and my favorite authors have sat right here for years. So it's really thrilling for me and thrilling that all of you would come. I'm going to spend a few minutes telling you about my book, and then I'm going to turn it over to Jayne Plank. You already know who she is, and maybe get a couple of the featured entrepreneurs in the book who are here tonight to say a few words, and then I'd really like to open it for questions and a conversation with all of you, because that's what I really care about. So I guess now I'll tell you why I wrote the book. My dream would be that it would start a conversation about the way that parents think about raising their children in terms of their careers. I feel that, and especially I feel that having talked to so many kids and parents writing this book, I feel that most kids are born with a passion, and that often that passion gets quashed along the way by well-meaning adults who want the best for their child and who are trying to be practical. Certainly when I grew up, when people grew up in the 60s and 70s and 80s, there was a routine that you had to follow. You had to study all of your courses and do really, really well in every... You had to do really, really well in all of your classes, and he's my...
Media advisor.
My media... my media advisor and sometime MC, Mark Bisnow, my wonderful husband. But anyhow, so when I was growing up, you had to do well in every single subject. Had to get an SAT tutor. Had to join lots of extracurricular activities so that you looked well-balanced. Had to get into a really good college. Had to do well in all of your grades, in all of your classes in college. Had to try to get into a really good grad school. And I just don't think that you necessarily still have to do that. Of course, you can do that, and some of the entrepreneurs in the book did that. Jayne and Bill Scott are here. Their son Tommy breezed through Brown. He was a great student. Breezed through Landon, breezed through Brown. Great kid, great academic. But not all kids are. And a lot of kids are sort of square pegs in round holes. And I feel like parents are trying to be helpful and practical, and so they say things like, don't spend so much time on the computer even though you love it. Work on your history. Or don't spend so much time on your art even though it's your passion. Work on your math. And yet, ironically, if they spend time on their computer and get really good at it, if they spend time on their art and get really good at it, maybe something wonderful can happen. One of the people in my book is Michael Chasen, who started Blackboard, a multi-billion dollar company. When he was young, his mom said that her friends used to tell her all the time that she was just letting him waste his life spending so much time on his computer, and he ended up starting a big computer company. Another kid, who Candace mentioned, Benny Blanco, whose mom just got criticism from the school from the time he started, from kindergarten, when his teacher called every week and said, Benny won't sit in the circle, and all the way through high school when the teachers got so frustrated. And he's sold over 100 million albums. He's written 15 number one songs. He's been Songwriter of the Year. I should say, in case some of you wonder why I'm talking about songwriters, is I define an entrepreneur as anyone who starts something. So it's not just a for-profit company. It's someone who started a nonprofit, a profits for purpose, like Tom's Shoes, an artist, an activist, or even an entrepreneur, somebody who starts a project within a company. It's anybody who starts something and turns a passion into a project. So this is really an accidental book for me. I had no interest or intention ever to write a book. And but as Candace mentioned, as many of you know, our son Elliot started Summit, these conferences of young entrepreneurs, and for the last 8 years, some might say I was stalking, but anyhow, I would go very frequently to all his events, and I'd meet all these young entrepreneurs, and just out of curiosity, I would ask them, how did you turn out the way you did? So willing to risk everything, to put everything on the table for an idea. And every single one of them said the same thing to me. They said, I had a mom who believed in me. I had a mom who told me I could do anything. And I was so struck by this, and I kept repeating it, as I sometimes do, to my children. And they said, you have to write a book. And I said, I'm not going to write a book. And they said, you have to write a book. And I said, I can't write a book. And they said, you have to write a book. I said, okay, I'll write a book. So that was 4 years ago. And here I am today at my book launch. So anyhow, I decided I should cast my net really broadly, not just in terms of what they went into, for-profit, not-profit, artist, activist, but also a completely diverse population. Half men, half women, of course. Every ethnic background, every socioeconomic background, every type of family situation. Married parents, divorced parents, single moms, blended families, small families, big families, small towns, big cities, born in the United States, born overseas, born in Canada, you name it, raised in very, very different ways. And in 10 core ways, these people were all basically raised the same. And in one way, every one of them was raised the same, which is that they had a parent who believed in them. And you'll say, well, every parent believes in their child. And I'll say, no, every parent loves their child. Every parent wants their child to be successful. Every parent wants their child to be happy. But I believe that many parents don't believe that if their child does the thing that makes their heart sing, that they can make a living. And none of the parents in this book did that. Every single parent, and sometimes it took a big gulp, but every single parent said, that's what you want to do? Go for it. We believe you. You'll be successful. We're here to support you however we can. And I think that's an incredible lesson, and it's one I hope we can talk about later. And now I'm so thrilled to turn it over to my friend Jayne Plank, who is, by the way, not just the mother of five extraordinary young men, one of whom started Under Armour, and the others are all great. But she's also an amazing person in her own right. She was the mayor of Kensington, and she's done lots of other fabulous things. And Jayne, I would just love to have you talk about some of the ways that you raised your kids and some of the lessons you imparted, and maybe a little bit about how Kevin started his various companies growing up.
Thank you very much. At first, I want to just thank you for putting this book together. Is it on? Yeah. Putting the. Can you? Oh, right here. Okay. It does. I still can't. Okay. That Margot got together and really put this in writing, and to create 10 rules that can help everyone do the best job for their child. I had 5 boys. They were all entrepreneurs. They all worked for themselves. They're all very different. But the one thing that I thought was very important for boys is to be involved in sports. And they all love sports, but not the same sport. Number 1 was into track. Number 4 was into track. Number 2 was into football. Number 5 was into football. Number 3 is in baseball. But you
I only had 2. It was so much easier to keep track.
I can just go through the list every time, and it'll be over in 5 minutes. But this idea of being able to have something as a guideline, because today you all are worried so much if you're doing it the right way. We did it by just hoping we were doing it the right way. And it was a freer time, and my boys are very, very different. But they had a lot of freedom. They all went to good schools. They all graduated from college, but one took a year off because he didn't know what he wanted to do, and he happened to be the one that was my merit scholar, and I had no worries, but he was a young boy and an August birthday, and he needed the extra year to find out what real work was before he came back and then got into a job that would do something he wanted to do. So, and then Kevin had a few troubles, and I used to say, you know, as far as I was concerned with him, education was an inconvenience on his continuum to success. He never had a problem. He just had other things that were more interesting. But it worked out, because that's the kind who take a chance and don't look for the secure. And from the time he was a little boy, when he was, you know, 7 or 8, he'd call up the first snowflake that fell, got all his buddies together so they could be the first ones out to plow the streets and the driveways and make a little money. And then the next time, I guess by high school, he had a tie-dye shirt for every music event or football or game. And then by the time he got to college and he got his scholarship, he went in as a walk-on and then got his scholarship. Then in college, you can't work if you're on scholarship. So he decided every boy gives his girlfriend roses on Valentine's Day. So that's how he created Cupid's Cup that is now at Maryland encouraging more entrepreneurs. But it was the same idea that he got all his buddies, and most of his friends that went to high school and college with him are still with him in Under Armour. He's a very good, loyal friend. They also... they did get into adversity at times, but as I used to always tell him, it isn't, you know, it takes time to do all those things, and there's always a problem that you don't have the solution for, but if you try long enough and more concentrated, you will find the solution. There are no problems except the solutions you haven't found, and you just have to look for them. And then I also tried to have special dates with the boys. When you have 5 together, it's hard to get mom's attention without the elbows. So it was very interesting. So, and I was traveling so much when I was in the Reagan administration where we knew each other. They could sign up when I traveled in the summertime to different events. And I think it helped them too, because we had special time and they also met other people and were able to get out. But they're having a wonderful adventure. But number 1, as you mentioned, it has to be a passion. It has to be something they want, not what you want. I'm afraid when Mike grew up, we had all the oughts and shoulds. But now it's to have the passion so they could go out and do it. And some of the, I know one gal standing up here was shaking her head. We had a long visit at something at other event at one time, and she was asking me questions with her one child. And so it just, you have to encourage them. And one of the things he always tells everybody too, to encourage your child, if you can't get a job, create a job. And start with a lemonade stand. Every time you see some kids on the corner with a lemonade stand, turn your car around, go back and give them $5 and buy all their lemonade. Show them, you know, it pays to really get out there and try and work. And you can do it. So it's your own self-confidence too. But this is something you build up by doing all these little things along the way. So I don't know. As I say, there were so many things that each one did, but I just want to commend you for putting it all together and giving us a road map on how we can help our children mature and go on. And with that, I think the people know the questions they want to ask, and I'd be glad to answer any that I can, because they're all very special, and this is a very special event, and we'll get our entrepreneurs going.
Thank you so much. I just want to comment on a couple things you said, and I'd like to get some of the wonderful entrepreneurs featured in my book to say a word also. But you mentioned sports. It was amazing to me how many of the entrepreneurs that I talked to actually competed at a very serious level in sports. It was almost like a joke. At the end, I'd say, by the way, did you do sports? And it was, oh, yes, I was on the Olympic development team for skiing. Oh, yes, I was the national equestrian champion. Oh, yes, I played soccer in college. And I began to realize that sports does so many things. It teaches you the trade-off between hard work and results. It teaches you the, if you're in a team sport, how to get along with others. It teaches you grit. It teaches you focus. It teaches you resilience. But mostly it teaches you to compete, and it teaches you to fail. Adam Braun's mother, he started Pencils of Promise. He's built schools all over the world. His mom said, and he played basketball at Brown, and his mom said she thought it was so great when he played basketball because he had to learn to lose gracefully in public. And if you're going to be an entrepreneur, you're going to lose a lot. And I love the quote from Billie Jean King, I don't call it failure, I call it feedback. And developing that approach to failure is key. And every one of these entrepreneurs told me, I was never afraid to fail. I was never punished for failing. And it's also interesting that a lot of the entrepreneurs actually didn't do sports, but they learned to compete in something else. Karen Merritt competed in art contests. for example, Reggie Agarwal, who started C-Vent, a big company here, competed in debate and running for student office. Benny Blanco, who we mentioned earlier, competed in rap contests, much to his mother's horror. but I think learning to compete and learning not to be afraid to fail is a fabulous skill for anybody who's going to be an entrepreneur. And then one other thing you mentioned that I just wanted to follow up on was when you were talking about a passion. So I think so often what happens with these kids, they develop a passion for something, and they get really, really good at it. And because they get really, really good at it, they work really, really hard at it. And because they get really hard at it, work really hard at it, they get a lot of confidence. My son Elliot was talking to someone, and he said, and I feel bad saying this in front of a Landon teacher, but anyhow, he said, you know, I didn't really like school that much, and I didn't work that hard in school. He said, but when I discovered tennis, he said, I was so passionate about it. He said, and that's where I learned grit and hard work and resilience and stick-to-itiveness. And even though he doesn't really play tennis that much anymore today, those are the qualities that helped me do what I do now. So I just think it's so important for kids to have that kind of passion and for parents to encourage them, whatever it is. The passions that I saw, it ended up being three different kinds of things. There were some, like my son Austin or Benny Blanco or many others, they had one passion and that was it sort of through their life. There were others where they had a passion that kind of morphed over time. So Joel Holland, who's at Burning Man, but he started Video Blocks. He's a local guy, and he used to love to take films, and then he wanted to film people, and then he was filming people about their different careers because he realized there was no information about careers, and then he realized he filmed Arnold Schwarzenegger. There was no interesting backdrop, and he thought, gee, I wish I could get a picture of the Hollywood sign. He realized you couldn't get stock footage. And he started to do that, and he started this little company, and now he's got, you know, thousands of people who buying his stock footage all the time. So sometimes the passion's morphed. And sometimes, like with Elliot, or a lot of the people whose passion was sports, they just developed grit, they developed a will to compete and to succeed, and then they ended up translating that into something completely different later. But learning to compete, I think, is key. I would love to have just a couple of the other moms or entrepreneurs here just say a word. So I have Jane Scott, whose son Tommy started Nantucket Nectars. And back when they had to be very brave. He'd gotten into Harvard Business School. He decided not to go. And this was back when every one of his friends was, being an entrepreneur wasn't cool like it is today. And every one of his friends was putting on a coat and tie and going to a job. And do you want to tell a little story?
I love these. You know, what you two say, I could just repeat. You know, sports, getting confidence, and friends, and a team working together, and having fun, as well as... as well as doing something worthwhile and sticking to it. Certainly, that's exactly. In fact, Tom started Lemonade Stand. There's a documentary out on similar to entrepreneurs and their mothers, and it's called Lemonade Stories. So. Now, what else could I say? You know, he did go to Brown. He didn't do well in every subject. I mean, he...
Flunked accounting.
And actually came back and went to, I think, Maryland and, you know, took accounting again because that was very important. He's now started something called the Nantucket Project, which is a think tank like Aspen Institute and similar to what Margot's son is doing. It's about to have its sixth year event, and it's everything from business and art and music and psychology and business and making money, and anyway, it's very exciting.
Tommy's terrific, and you guys should be so proud.
Well, of course we are. And, you know, it's such a fabulous story how these boys, you know, friends from the past, worked together on Nantucket Nectar for a long time, maybe 16 years? Yes, and some of them are still with him now at the Nantucket Project. And he's also at Yale Divinity School. It's taking him a long time. He's still got another semester. He's always interested in the big question, what's it all about? And
well, that is the question.
I think he'll eventually do some kind of film.
Thank you so much.
Okay.
To the mother, not me.
I'd also love to have Karen Merrick say a word. She and her husband, Philip, started one of the most successful companies in the Washington region, Web Methods, where my husband worked for a little while. And she's in a wonderful section I have called Entrepreneurs Raising Entrepreneurs, where people like Karen, who are successful entrepreneurs, are now raising their own kids and having to bring them up in very different circumstances where, as someone says, you have to go from we can't do that to we won't do that. But in order to do that, you have to know why you won't, you have to know what your values are, and you have to be able to articulate your values. And so in some ways, it's more challenging to bring kids up with grit when it's a different environment. And I know you've talked about sports also, but anything you'd like to add?
Thank you. Well, by the way, I think that Margot's book is perfect not only for parents, but grandparents, aunts and uncles, teachers,
right, everyone,
you know, godparents,
one.
Next door neighbors, friends. But thank you. I was so honored to be in this book, and I've known Margot for many years, and Margot exudes an entrepreneurial spirit in everything that she does. She's always trying new ideas and bringing people together, and so it's great to be part of Team Margot. The one thing that comes to mind is how in our family, I come from a family with working class parents. Our parents worked a lot. My father was going to college at night for most of my life and got his MBA on the GI Bill. And so, but they have four children, and every single one of us has started a business. And some of us have started multiple businesses or nonprofits on top of our businesses. And I often think, how can it be that, you know, my father was a utility company lineman and my mother was a school secretary for the county in Southern California, and how can that be? And I think part of it is that they were really young when they got married and they were juggling a lot. And so because they were juggling a lot, they kept giving us more to do. And so that built confidence in us. And I also think that because we had young parents and you know, we figured out there was a little bit of a rebel aspect in the family culture. And I think that part of you has to feel that way in a way, which is you can't tell me I can't do that. And that's definitely a family dynamic in our family. And the one other thing that I would say is that you really have to step outside of your comfort zone with your kids. We have two sons, a rising ninth grader, a rising senior in high school. And our oldest son has loved planes his whole life, and he was going to get his pilot's license on his 17th birthday last year, except that he got a concussion from football. So he's getting it now. He's flying solos. He's got his first cross-country night flight Monday night. And, you know, my husband and I are looking at each other saying, we've let him do this. We funded the lessons, you know, but this is the only thing he has ever really thrown himself all into. And so I'd love to hear what Jayne and Margot have to say, and some of the other moms, about how you deal with that sense of knowing that your child is up there, you know, in danger, or you're just outside of your comfort zone and you feel so vulnerable. So I'm handing it back over to you, Margot.
Thank you so much. I want to mention one other thing, because I've just noticed that Earl Jackson is over there. And he was one of Austin's mentors in high school. He's the band director. And I have a chapter on having your child have a mentor. It was a mentor who convinced Tommy Scott that it was okay not to go to Harvard Business School, and who convinced his parents that it was okay to let him not go to business school. Austin was not a typical student. His passion was music. He wasn't an all-around great student, and having someone like Earl Jackson believe in him, show him so much support, be there for him, I can't tell you how much that meant in his confidence. And for me, maybe the highlight of high school was when he let Austin conduct the entire concert band in one of his compositions. And just to have that kind of support from a teacher, any mentor, it just means so much to a child, and helps them so much, I think, to gain confidence. I don't know if there's anyone else, because it's hard to see so many people, who's here, who's in the book. But if you are, oh my gosh, so sorry, Kathy Roth Duque. I'm so excited, yes. So Kathy started this fabulous nonprofit called Blue Star Families. Do you want to talk for 1 minute about what your mom did for you, or you want, I guess they want you to come.
Well, I also love the book, and I think any parent is going to really love it. and I have a bunch of copies to give to other friends. So thank you for writing it, Margot. I get to talk from the perspective of a kid who was raised by a mother, which I think can be helpful. One thing, and Margot did such a beautiful job in writing it up. When I read it, it really made me feel teary because it's so on and so connected. My parents had a tough time when I was growing up, and they did a lot of things wrong. But what I learned from that is that you can do a lot of things wrong. There's a couple very important things that you need to do right, and you can get away with a lot of other things. And the most important thing was that I always knew every day that they really loved me. And for my mother in particular, and I try to use this with my own children since the time they were little, and they're here, Charlie and Sophie, that I always knew it was a pleasure for her to be my mother. And I think sometimes when we're so anxious in this modern day, we forget that children need to feel that it's not a burden to be your child, that it's not driving you crazy or taking every one of your resources, but it's a pleasure. And because it was a pleasure, I felt like I was empowered to think anything and to say anything and to have her attention for any reason, because she wanted to hear what I had to say. If I came up with a brilliant idea that wasn't really so brilliant, every 15-year-old has had it, she listened to it as though it was brilliant. And that feeling of having that attention and feeling like I deserve to have that attention, that allows you to go everywhere. So I always started things whenever I thought something was missing, you know, we should have a, and I was interested in writing initially, but we should have a literary magazine. So I started one, and we should have a journal in my graduate school when I went to Princeton. There wasn't one, so I started one. I never felt like I couldn't. I felt it was my responsibility to, because I could. And so when I married someone in the military and we found ourselves in a long war, and I thought, this is a community that needs much more support than it has, and the people who are part of the community need to be the ones who are articulating what that is. I didn't think, do I have a right to do this? I thought, I have to do this because I recognize it has to be done and it's my responsibility. But it all goes back to that feeling from my parent, and I really appreciate Margot raising that and bringing it back to me. And of course, you don't do anything alone. The whole team and the whole staff did it, but it's the largest organization that supports military families now, and it goes back to one person believing in their child.
Thank you so much, Kathy. So, if anyone has comments or questions for me or Kathy or Karen or Jayne or anyone.
Margot, I understand the common denominator is the passion and the supportive parent, but I'm very curious, did you see a trend where most of the parents, helicopter parents, very, very involved, or most of them laissez-faire, I support you, but you do it yourself?
Most of the parents were more hands-off. That was one of the areas where there wasn't commonality. There were some parents who were much more involved. I have to admit, I was more on the involved end. But the majority of parents were more hands-off, especially the parents of the entrepreneurs who are now in their 40s. Mm-hmm. And Jayne and I talk about this all the time. And I let her answer. She always says if she were raising kids today, she'd be in jail. But one of the moms in the book, Esther Wojcicki, who raised one daughter, CEO of YouTube, and one daughter started 23andMe. And it's the same thing. She said her kids would do chores around the house, get on their bike downtown, spend their money. They were 6 years old. They spent a year in Paris. Her kids would walk downstairs. They were like 6 and 8. She'd send them to the boulangerie to get bread. They were 8 years old. She put a tag on their neck and sent them down to Los Angeles to visit their grandmother. I mean, just incredible freedom. And for me, raising children, the hardest thing was figuring out how to let go in a responsible and thoughtful way. It didn't come naturally or easily to me. If I had it to do again, I would give them more freedom, younger. I've thought about this so much, and my brother and I have talked about when we were young, we'd, you know, come home from school, have a snack, and go out and play and come in when the streetlights came on. And people mm-hmm. don't do that anymore, and I've been thinking about this since Jayne and I were talking the other day. My kids played baseball at the little league field right up here, and we live like six blocks away, and they wouldn't have to cross a busy street. And it's not that I never let them walk home, it's that it never occurred to me to let them walk home. And I'm thinking, like, why? You know, why? I mean, they could have walked home. Nothing would have happened. So I don't know. I think the more freedom you can give them, and some of the parents, the amount of freedom they got was unbelievable. Michael Skolnick was 14. He wanted to work for a film or theater company in New York. They lived in Westchester. He wrote to 80 people. Blue Man Group said yes. His parents said, we work, we can't drive you back and forth. If you can find somewhere to live, it's fine. And at 14, he found someone, his parent, with an apartment in Manhattan, and they let him live in Manhattan for the summer. And he said, I know that wouldn't work for everybody, but they trusted me, I honored their trust, and they let me fly, and it worked for me. Do you want to talk a little about how you...
Well, I grew up very free. I grew up here in Washington, and this was a wonderful, wonderful city when I was growing up. I happen to be a seventh-generation Washingtonian, so my roots are deep. And so I took a streetcar and two buses and walked probably six blocks to get to school from sixth grade on, I think it was. And nobody told me I was, you know, underprivileged. It was what you did. And with my own kids, too, because I used to give them quarters to go across the street to the park after the lights needed to come on so they could play basketball after supper. And they could take their bikes and go all over all day, and you didn't know where they were. I mean, but you knew everybody in the neighborhood would know where they were. So it was a very comfortable relationship here. That was in Kensington. I left here and came to Maryland when I came with my children. So it was harder to raise someone in the city at that point, especially five boys who wanted to be out riding bikes and skating and doing everything. But they walked to school, too, and across Connecticut Avenue. Probably the first time. And I won't have Katya tell you what happened one of those trips. But she lived on the corner. So it was, you know, it was a very open community around here. And I do think that gave them a lot of leverage to know how to make things happen and how to work with people. And they knew everybody, and they had the safety, and they knew I was behind them, and if they needed anything, but we didn't have cell phones, and they didn't. They just came home and the lights went on, as you suggested. In fact, I even used to pull a tube out of the television, in those early televisions, so that it never got repaired until September. I didn't have that argument.
I've just noticed one other entrepreneur in the book. Maimah, can you come on up here? And has walked up, and I would just like her to talk for 1 minute. She's so inspirational. She started a nonprofit called Tigerlily Foundation. She was diagnosed with breast cancer at 32, and realized that there was no right up here. And realized that there were no resources for young women with breast cancer, and she started this nonprofit. And I've known her for years because we covered a lot of nonprofits at the scene, and it wasn't until I interviewed for the book that I learned what an incredibly harrowing experience she'd had earlier in her life. Can you just talk for 1 minute about what your mom went through to get your dad
out of jail? Oh, yeah. So everybody, thanks for having me. I'm so honored to be in the book. And thanks for being here for Margot. She's an amazing person. And thanks to God for life, for friendship, and opportunity. My name's Maimah Karmo. I'm from Liberia, West Africa. I came here at 15 years old as an immigrant with only one suitcase. My parents, during one of the wars there, my dad had been put in jail. And it was a really bad time. We were in hiding for a number of days. And people were getting killed all over the place. And
put in jail because he was in the opposition. I mean,
he wasn't following what the government wanted. So they had jailed him, and falsely, of course. And my mom was told to not go rescue my dad. She was told to stay in hiding to save our lives and her life. But she loved her husband, and so when he went into jail, he went to actually defend us, because if he hadn't gone to the prison, they were going to come to find our family. So he got dressed and went into the eye of the storm to save us from them coming to the house. And my mom, days later, went to the prisons to find my dad and rescue him. And so what they taught me was that love is more powerful than anything, and family is more powerful than anything, and that whatever your fears are, you can overcome them. Just follow your heart, follow your passion, and they gave their lives for us. And as a result, I'm here. I've been here for 27 years in America. I'm alive. And when I got breast cancer, my parents' strength at the time helped me to know I could survive and I could fight through that. So they taught me what makes me me. And so that's kind of what got me into philanthropy, into community work. And Margot, thank you for featuring my story. I don't want to talk too long, but thank you.
Thank you so much.
I'm Jay Smith. I actually run a freshman and sophomore entrepreneurship program at the University of Maryland. So I also want to thank Kevin for all he's done for the university. Two things. One is, I wanted to say to all the parents, we've now been running this for 7 years. We've had programs there for a long time, that, you know, the entrepreneurial experience, even if things don't work well necessarily, it is a huge learning experience. And employers are really on the lookout for students that have this experience that they can apply in whatever types of companies they are. I do have questions for you or some of the other parents about the school systems, and, you know, maybe this will open a little bit of controversy. You know, what do you think that the school systems, K through 12, colleges, could be doing more of to be helping out in this area, to encouraging students?
I have one in particular. I think we need more vo-tech to make people think, or kids think, that everybody has to go to college is not the right answer, and that's not the right way to send it. We need to be plumbers. We need plumbers. Mm-hmm. We need electricians. We need carpenters. And actually, when the kids were little, we lived up near Einstein, where I still have a house. That's where I got my car repaired. And the kids were happy to do it, and then they did all these other things. And if they want to go to college after that, they have something to fall back on, and not mommy or daddy or alone. And they save up, and that's what my husband did. He worked overseas and saved money to go to graduate school and came back and went to graduate school. But I think vo-tech is the biggest mistake. In fact, when KGH closed, the gal on the school board and I tried to get them to keep it and make it into a total vo-tech school. But we've got this fallacy that everybody has to go to college. And some artists would rather draw than go to college.
I was also lucky because my kids went to a school that, even though they were different from most of the students, the school really accommodated them. And for example, Austin's senior year in high school, for his English class, he read a book about Bob Dylan, and then he wrote a song in the style of Bob Dylan. Mm. And they let him do that. And it was wonderful. Not all schools are so accommodating. And I just think one of the moms told me that the teacher called and said, your son doesn't like to sit still. And she said, well, couldn't you have him just sit in the back row, and then if he has to stand up, he won't bother people? And they said, oh, yeah, okay. But I just think a lot of kids have different learning styles. A lot of kids have different needs. A lot of kids have different interests. And I will say, though, about Landon, like, why my son had to know that there were, like, 17 Lord Baltimores for Maryland. It's like, I don't know. You know, maybe there's some stuff that they're being asked to learn that they don't really need to know. I don't think I've used geometry since 10th grade. But, you know, I just think it's good for schools. To teach kids to think. It's good for schools to teach kids to write. It's good for schools to teach kids to question and to analyze. And to me, that's the most important thing that you can get from an education. And then maybe different tracks, so that, you know, the kids who are more interested in art don't have to take all those other classes, and the kids that are more interested in computers. I think Florida now will allow you to take coding as a foreign language, which I think is fantastic.
Thank you.
Thank you. Elizabeth?
Hi, Margot. First of all, this is great, so thank you. I have two questions. So I'm a mother of a single I mean, I'm a single mother of a little girl over there, and she likes to say that we are not single, that I have her. So, so I'm sorry I'm labeling myself as that tonight, but this is going to help others understand my question. Public or private school? As I look around at the different programs, I'm seeing public school, I don't know, maybe more sterile, less arts in the curriculum in the elementary school. I think in the high school it's more diverse. And then I see different people coming out of private schools where they have access to more interesting subject matters. Did you find a common theme amongst the people that you interviewed?
So the common theme was that the parents listened to their child, and if their child wasn't thriving, they moved them.
Okay.
And sometimes they homeschooled them. Sometimes they put them in a charter. Sometimes they took them out of a small private school and put them in a big public school. Sometimes they took them out of a big public school and put them in a private school. I don't think there's an answer. It's not one size fits all. That's the whole point of this book, is that you have to listen to your child and you have to see what your child needs, and then you have to help your child get that.
Okay.
One of the kids in the book, Jackie Mason, who runs Charm Boutique in Georgetown, I asked her once, I said, remind me, where did you go to high school? And she said, you know, I went to so many high schools because I kept getting asked to leave. But she had learning issues, and her mom worked with her, and she got through, and she's doing wonderfully today. So I just think it's whatever your child needs.
Okay. And then my other question is, in a way, I feel like the book is speaking to me and that I'm raising both of us, because I still have things I want to do in my life and dreams that I want to achieve. I'm trying to figure out how to raise my little girl and make sure everything is done for her so that she is raised well and comes out successful. But at the same time, I'm raising myself to strive for what I want to achieve. So what is the balance? Is there a secret answer here?
In the crowd.
So one of the things I loved about this book is that you don't have to be with your child like every minute of the day. Like so many of these parents work, I would say 70% of the parents worked full time. And they just weren't there that much. And some of them really worked full time. And all the kids told me, you know, our parents were there when they needed us, when we needed them. Our parents were always there for us. And the parents said, like, I was busy. I just couldn't help them figure out their homework. They had to figure it out for themselves. Sometimes if they have to work a little harder, it's okay. But all the kids knew at the end of the day, even if their kids, you know, they weren't with their kids every minute, they knew their parents loved them. One of my favorite stories this one person said, like, his parents had two jobs, worked around the clock, had all these other passions and interests outside, and he was the only kid whose parents never came to his games when he played sports in high school because they were too busy. And it's one of my favorite stories. His mom got a call one day and said, there's going to be a potluck for the basketball team at the end of the season. We wondered if you'd like to bring something. And she said, Michael plays basketball? So I would say follow your passion. Okay. She knows you love her. She'll be fine.
Cool. Thank you. Oh, I had a quick question about privilege when it comes to entrepreneurs. In raising entrepreneurs, I guess, what advice would you give for parents of lesser means who maybe don't have access to a lot of opportunities for children who want to pursue their dream? How do you balance the dream and pragmatism,
I guess? It was actually really important to me to have a very diverse socioeconomic group here. And it goes from like single moms barely making it to kind of upper middle class, nobody hugely wealthy. Because we just, you know, and all these people, I mean, there was one kid who wanted to go to school and her mom said, we can't afford it. You're just going to have to figure it out. And she found somebody with a garage and said, if you pay the $100 a month storage fee to put our stuff in the garage, you can live in the garage. And she lived in the garage and she went to school. And these people, they had, you know, and so many, and what something else I really liked was that there was no correlation between how wealthy the families were and how much they gave. So some of the wealthier families, their kids always had jobs, always had to work for everything. Some of the families with fewer means said, like, we didn't, I look back now and I realize we didn't have very much, but we always were there on Thanksgiving, you know, working for other people, contributing, doing stuff for other people. So I think it's just the attitude. I don't think it's the money. Hi, Chris.
Hi, how you doing, Margo? So I got a question. It's the flip side of freedom and allowing and nurturing and so forth. It's boundaries. And I was wondering if you might be able to talk a little bit about boundaries. I know at the end of this, you talk about Marcos Williams, the famous quote about allowing him to fail because he didn't bring his homework. But you know, what about the flip side of that? Where do you stifle? You know, is there boundaries on the other side? So that's my question.
So actually, this was another area where there was no commonality, but something that really interested me is a lot of the parents were very strict in terms of rules. No television during the week, bedtimes, certain kind of activities they weren't allowed to do, commitments from their kids not to drink or smoke or whatever. And yet they gave their kids huge freedom, you know, tell me you're not going to smoke, tell me you're not going to drink, tell me you're not going to watch TV, you can't swear, you can't do this, you can't do that. But sure, you can go off to Africa for 3 months, you know, over the summer, if that's your passion, because we trust you. And I think, again, this is something every parent has to figure out what works for their family and what goes with their own values and morals. And but at the end of the day, as long as the kids know what the expectations are and know that their parents love them and know that their parents trust them. And Angela Duckworth, whom I think is phenomenal, she wrote the book on grit and first pioneered the concept of grit, and she has a new book out now called Mindset. And she has a whole chapter in there on parenting for grit. And basically how she describes raising kids, the ideal way, is how all of the kids in this book were raised, which was a lot of expectations, a fair amount of rules, and complete freedom to pursue what they wanted. So thank you. I'm so humbled that all of you came. Thank you so much.
And we should thank you.